That's what it is.
Well, I'm just, I will, the assumption is, and by the way, if no one else does, I'll declare an interest because it's in will of council's name, as a councillor, I suppose, that's the issue. But, so the logic is that if this was a private building in the centre of Hamlet Square, it could be demolished with no future plan of what to do with that piece of land. What we have here is obviously demolished the building, which is, I believe, involved with longer term plans and assets and whatever, on behalf of the applicants. And then no answer what will be there. So if we took the logic of refusing it, they could come back with an application for demolition and leave a big hole in the ground, leave a pile of, leave a just level rubble. What they're saying is that in the temporary period when after demolition, we will car park it and use it as temporary use, looking for future development. That seems an extremely sensible way forward if you are trying to be flexible and regenerate the town and an important part of the town. It doesn't make any sense to simply refuse something because they've given an explanation of what they're doing post demolition. So they can demolish it and leave an eyesore there. Imagine the criticism we would get there as a planning committee. They come up with a temporary solution which is going to be used by car park and staff. But it is what it is. A movable plan within the town centre. We have ambitious plans for the town centre, I hope, to move forward. So it just seems crazy. I'll withdraw, by the way, the word liberty. But it does seem that the green angle that some councillors come from dominates common sense sometimes. And this is a common sense solution to a demolition proposal. And I would be mindful to be green in this.
Thank you for withdrawing the statement and thank you for your comments.
I take up and it was I thought that David made a decent level argument. So yes,
his resolution to
the I just wanted to explore some. The argument is potentially that we're applying double standard, possibly, or we're seeking to benefit this applicant for one reason or another. It'd be interesting to know what view we would take if a private building in the area decided they wanted to flatten themselves and open a car park on the site and charge for it. Would we take a view that there was enough car parking in the area as it was and not permit also flattening of commercial properties to open car parks? That'd be the first point there. The second thing that actually the concern that I had when I read the report was that this is a significant site on the edge of Hampton Square Conservation Area. Steve alludes to the potential regeneration of that whole site, notwithstanding that there seems to be an incremental approach here. We'll demolish the annex and move everyone into the current treasury building. Then we'll demolish the current treasury building. If one looks at the Google view online, this is why I made a mention of that, wanted to be a lot ugly building, which what we would allow on that sort of corner with hotel or some description on there. So the chances are that if there is to be a bespoke development on that corner, views out of the conservation area, the chances are the area that's currently occupied by the annex will probably be the car park associated with it. However, my concern was it is a key town centre site that Steve's alluded to that. It has views in and out of the significant conservation area in the town. What I think I have wanted to see before the committee is a development plan for the site. Is some sort of vision, again, that Steve alludes to, rather than, oh, well, I think what we'll do is tomorrow says we'll put a car park on it. Steve says temporary. 5 years is some temporary. You know, unless we're
mistaken.
Well, unless we wish to alter the condition and say, I tell you what, you've had it for 12 months, but let's see some sort of, some sort of vision for this important site rather than this, while the haphazard approach that the applicant, which is the council, is taking towards it. And should we say, what is it we want on site? We should be forcing the applicant to come forward with a development brief, to shift the staff around, declare it surplus, and get something in place. I think that's the sort of, we talk about bold visions of £1 billion, not let's have a car park on this for 5 years, and that'll buy us some. No, I think I want to show the government brief for that whole set, because it's a significant one, close to a significant conservation area. And if refusing this sends the message back to officers, that's really the approach we need to do, much rather than that, I would be happy to refuse on those terms.
Thank you. Just to clarify a couple of things, we have been told, although we have been told late, the reason behind the requirement for it to be a car park is because of the other site which provides parking spaces for council staff is to be withdrawn. So we're talking about 50 parking spaces and we're now talking about 75, and that could be the reason why officers are saying, I'm not sure if it's going to be paying display, because part of it might be paying display, part of it might be for staff. Maybe they'll move more staff into there. Maybe we're just in the unknown at this point in time. Okay, David.
Yeah, just to sort of add a bit of context to this, as possibly one of the oldest people in this room, I remember coming back through Liverpool when I went to school there and seeing the damage and destruction that our new friends, the Germans, had caused after the Second World War, where half of the centre of Liverpool was obliterated. And at the time, there weren't that many cars around, but then they did use those sites for many years as car parks in the meantime until new properties were developed. So I see this as being a temporary arrangement. 5 years is, I accept, quite a long time. But I just see it as temporarily using a piece of land that would otherwise be left to grow weeds for a purpose and maybe get some revenue out of it, or at least reduction in congestion from the rest of Birkenhead. So I can only see it as a plus-plus idea, but I would endorse what Stuart has said concerning maybe putting a bit of pressure on our own council to see if they can come up with a solution rather than getting rid of it as an asset and letting somebody else build something there, or perhaps developing something positive and revenue-producing in place here. So I'm inclined to approve this on the ground to be a sensible solution at this time for the site that would otherwise just have to be in the
release. Okay, thank you, James. I think David Ball wanted to make a few comments on this.
Just very quickly, obviously Birkenhead is our key town centre. There are a number of discussions going on at the moment around redevelopment proposals for the area. We've been doing work on the strategic regeneration framework, and as you know, the council at the present time is exploring the establishment of a property company, which will, when it's set up, one of its key areas of targeting regeneration future development is in and around Birkenhead. So, as I understand it, the purpose of this planning application is just to seek a temporary car parking use for the site while those plans and the property company set up and developed, and then we can bring forward not only this site but a number of other sites that we're talking to people about at the moment in a comprehensive way for the benefit of Birkenhead. So I hope that helps.
Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Well, just to follow on what Dave said, I think as Stuart said, it would be much better if the committee, if we were presented with much more detailed plans and proposals and a vision of the right for sites like this. I think what's clear from the comments we've seen today is that the officers don't intend this to be a car park forever. They want it to be something else, presumably something similar to what's happening across the road in terms of residential development, which I think is perfectly sensible, because we're seeing the whole Hamilton Square area really expand in terms of residential occupation. I just want to really clarify something in terms of ideas that lack sanity. I mean, the one that really lacks sanity is if you knock this down and just leave it. That's not what the council is going to do. The council is currently using this building to accommodate staff. I took the trouble of speaking to some of the staff who worked there, and what they wanted was for it to be retained for staff to continue to work there. It's up to the council if they don't want to do that, that's fine. But that is not to say that they're just going to demolish it and leave it derelict, and that is the theft idea of all.
Quite frankly, Chair, I'm outraged that that has absolutely nothing to do with planning whatsoever. I want to stay in this building, the tight comments. That's not what planning should be discussing. And no wonder people outside are beginning to wonder whether we can deliver anything in planning. We should be enabling instead of obstructing constantly.
Thank you, Steve. Any other comments? Okay, well, the officer's recommendation is to approve the subject of conditions listed and the conditions on the late list. All those in favour of approval? Can I have a mover?
I'll move it, Chair.
Second one. All those in favour? Against? Okay, that's carried, thank you.
Yes, we're not going to contest the proceedings, so yes, we go with the
for the listening, is that the council was taking that to part of the concern of the applied schemes. So, yes, answer to your question.
Yeah, I think it was the general force of what I was saying. It sounds like you were given that we are, I mean, from an outsider looking in, I'm not the eagle head on the one thing, we are the one being actually against it. Yeah, so I'm not confident to say it yet, but as it turns out, we are actually siding with the complainants on this and accepted, if you like, our own errors, if you like, the selection of information.
Yeah, so just like that, we accept that we made an error in granting the planning permission down to conditions. So in terms, as Colin said, with the statements, we were putting factual statements together from the pilot, the chronology of events and all of the paperwork that we've got as part of that.
And the second word is, well, presumably there is a financial a burden, if you like, to the main complaint, which is of, if you like, no fault of their own. So what are any arrangements in hand, if you like, to support the lead complainants in this? Because clearly, they are the ones taking the lead, if you like, but nevertheless, the both of the responsibility lies with the council for the error.
The thoughts of all are representative, and I'll expect them to make an application or a consequence.
And would you deal with that would be opposed?
Well, I don't think I can comment on until I know the details of the application. In principle, I think it's an application the council would expect.
Yeah, so I think probably if we leave it at that, if the committee's okay with that, that's it. acquisition process and then get the report coming back.
So that's my point, so we are going to report back after this decision from the government.
Yeah, I think what Dave Ball has said is that he will keep us updated either outside of the meeting or during the committee meetings, and then obviously we'll